So where's this wood going?
Somewhere local, I think Dewey. Somewhere in Dewey.
Okay.
This is a mixed load. Got all the hardwoods in it. Pines, spruces, black walnut. Yeah, this is a good mix load back here.
You definitely need it in this weather.
Yeah.
Yeah, firewood's, you don't make any money doing firewood, but
I think they're going,
you get just enough to cover your bills, basically.
So this is a way to help maintain.
Well, this is a working men's shelter.
Okay.
So what we've done is we've partnered with Helping Hands Ministry. We're building a tiny home, a veterans on patrol, military style compound like we have in Bravo. The trailers and stuff, we're using this as a recovery center to get people away from the cities where there's meth, heroin, where their addictions are right there in their face. We try to get them out here because it's going to be a whole lot harder to get here in the middle of nowhere than it is at a park, you know.
Well, and they suggest that, like, when you're leaving jail, they want to move you someplace where you're away from the people that got you there. Yeah. In the addictions.
So it's, but it's peaceful.
That's a tough one to deal with, the addictions.
There are. We didn't really get involved in it in the beginning because they're really complicated.
Yeah,
the
there's no easy
recovery
answer.
Addictions, they're demons. Until people can call out their demons by name, there's no power over them, you know.
So basically it takes a lot of patience, and you give them like 3 or 4 chances, and then
we don't put a time limit. They can make one big screw up and that's it. They can screw up 50 times and they're still trying and still going to meetings and still making an effort and not giving up.
How do you feel about when you do have to give up on somebody?
Well, we never give up on people. When the minute they give up on themselves, there's nothing we can't do. There's nothing we can do. So to me, it's just being rational. It's, look, how many other people are going to go out and attempt to do what we're doing? Not a lot. We do amazing things every day, and only a few people get to experience it. And that's the thing that drives me crazy, is they don't get to see the smiles, be part of the hugs, see the businesses respond to you in a respectful manner, and they're actually glad you're there. Thank you. You know,
So in other words, you don't kick out anyone because of their addictions. They end up kicking themselves out.
Well, would they give up on themselves?
Yeah, then there's nothing you can do.
And sometimes people give up on themselves 50 times before they finally get it right, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a poster child for second chances. I needed a million of them. As far as I'm concerned, you never run out of second chances.
So Lewis was at a meeting with us back when John Ritzenheimer was doing his protest, trying to get everybody involved. And Lewis was the only one that went out and did it right after that. Like his saying, does it right.
Yeah.
Everyone else, did nothing. Out of all the organizations there, nobody did anything. They all complained about what he was doing and didn't even bother to help him.
And you think that Lewis is doing the more positive impact in the world than everybody else was?
He's not limiting people by race, color, creed. He's taking the vets off the streets, using civilian volunteers to put it all together, and then the veterans run the bases. So he's got guys like us coming up volunteering, helping out, and a lot of the vets don't appreciate that the volunteers are there, but that's what runs his circles everywhere he needs to go.
Yeah.
Without the volunteers, it wouldn't work. And without hunting having a mission, a good mission like hunting vets, that's the difference. He's got a good cause going.
Yeah.
Everybody else was trying to build bases and arm up, and Lewis said, no, that's not what we're doing. We don't care if you're a Muslim. We don't care what religion you are. So that was the difference between him and everybody else that wanted to do something or said they wanted to do something.
He was actually doing some positive.
He actually, well, it was self-sacrifice.
Right.
He climbed a pole one day and made awareness for his friend known because the VA wasn't helping him. So he was able to get attention to that. And then it grew from there. People were following it. And then the families came in and started donating. And then he started doing his walkabouts, protecting vets down in Phoenix. The first call that came out, call to action, was homeless vets were, disabled veterans were being beaten and robbed for their cell phones and their checks down in Phoenix on Camelback 19th. And that's where the call to action came. Everybody showed up and pitched in, but I don't see any of those militia men or any of those guys helping at all. None of them are volunteering. Well, they are, just a very few of them. The other guys ran off and started organizations that just basically little groups and then complain about what Lewis is doing.
Yeah. We're gonna go in the chicken coop. Oh, you're feeding them?
Yeah, so they'll move out of the way.
Oh, okay.
Watch out. But you can do this and it'll get them out, hopefully. Back. Wait just a second.
Okay.
Here we go. Oh, they lay their eggs in there. We go in there every morning and check. We got water.
Let's see.
You're like, who are you?
I never get to hang with the chickens.
Oh, oop. Are you okay?
No, I'm fine. Oh, is he laying an egg?
Oh, yeah, probably. Oh. Yep, she's laying an egg.
She's getting all ballooned up.
Oh, yeah. They get huge when they're laying eggs. What are you doing?
Look at that guy.
The way they walk is so funny.
Oh, wow, that's so cool. Friendly, too.
Yeah, don't pet him.
No, I won't pet him. Oh, there we go. Oh, there it comes. Here it comes. Boom.
That's the first time I've ever seen that happen.
Wow.
Oh, they're getting
it. Okay, I'll get out your way. Wow, that was fantastic.
I've never seen that happen before.
Well, cool. The bunny. So what do you guys...
This is Captain's bunny.
So what do you guys do with the bunnies?
Actually, so there's somebody named Captain. He's really awesome.
Yeah?
He's amazing, and he, like, these are his animals.
Oh, yeah, they're very aggressive. They're the boys.
Yep.
Like, the roosters.
That was my favorite.
Oh, yeah, with the cool hairdo?
Oh, yeah.
Look at him.
These two got crazy.
He looks like a rock star. Yeah.
But they only keep three of them in here, because if there would be any more, there would be a lot of rooster fights.
Oh, okay.
And we wouldn't want that happening.
No.
And these guys have lived with each other for, like, ever.
Okay. So how long has it been since I've been able to interview? About a year and a half, I'm guessing?
No, it's been a year. It was December last year.
Oh,
it was awesome. December last year.
And you've done quite a bit in a year.
Yeah, we've expanded. Within 16 months, at one time, we had 8 camps. Right now, we've got 4. They're in a stable location, and they're, you know, they're doing really good. But our plan is, you know, it's a statewide search and rescue for homeless veterans. So we are building 22 encampments in Arizona. We're going to have 22 to raise awareness for the 22 veteran suicides per day. Each one of these camps, when all are completed, each of them are going to be named after a war fighter that we've lost to suicide because we failed to set aside our political differences, our ideological differences, religious differences, racial differences, whatever it is, we failed. As of right now, it's still, you're losing a veteran every day, every hour, you're losing a vet on average. I mean, that's pretty close to accurate. So every hour, an hour after you watch this, there'll be one gone. Hour after that, another one. And it's not going to stop. But we hope in Arizona we can at least put a stop to it in our state and set a precedence that other states will follow. So, I mean, we're doing good. ups and downs. We're very disorganized and dysfunctional, but that's because we have to be. There's so many people that try to come in and want to organize us and give us this professional look that'd be accepted by corporations, but that's not how we reach the people we're trying to reach. We operate so good because it's so dysfunctional and it's disorganized. You know, it is the life of the homeless individual in America. It's a dysfunctional life. There's no organization. There's no structure. We're trying to instill structure, but we're trying to give it to them in small doses so they get the full structure they need so they can make it on their own in their own place. It's a transitioning camp. They're not militia camps designed to take over the government. We're not putting people on the border, homeless vets down there to fight the cartels. I mean, you still hear those things.
These are things that people, other people come up with?
Yeah, well, you'll hear all kinds of things. But what people need to do is come down and see. You can listen and read whatever you want to read online, you know. You can find stories that praise me like Jesus Christ, or they condemn me like I'm Satan himself. It doesn't matter. The only way to know is to go out and see what we're doing. And it's just a bunch of us, and we're normal people, but we've got big hearts, and we care about the ones that we're out here for. That's why we're out here. At the end of the day, we're out here for them. And we go through a lot of controversies. We go through a lot of structural changes. We go through homeless or volunteers as quick as we do the homeless in and out of our camps. But we love for anyone to come and try, because you're either going to fall in love with what we're doing and you're going to love the people that we're helping, or you're going to go find some other purpose for you. Could not have to do anything with homelessness. Could be breast cancer. Could be autistic children. There are plenty of needs out there in America right now where you could find a good cause, get together with your neighbors, and do it the exact opposite that everyone else is doing. That's why we work. We don't get a building and design a shelter and a program and say you're stuck in these four walls. We don't make stringent rules and restrict the freedoms of individuals. You got to do it the exact opposite, because there are people that are falling through the cracks, which means they're being provided every type of avenue that's available to them. There's plenty of, but they're not being reached. In order to reach those people, you have to do the opposite of what the other programs are doing to reach them. And you have to actually live with them, build trust with them. I mean, it's 16 months right now, and there's no end in sight. We were only at 4 functioning camps. We got 18 more to build. More people who come down and get involved, the quicker we'll get it done. But we're going to get it done anyways. We're not going to stop. We're not going to quit. We didn't just give our word to say that we're going to go check every homeless veteran, you know, and did not do it. There's plenty of places in Arizona right now where if we just had families who were aware of what we were doing, agree to come out and cook a meal for the base or drop off blankets or clean out their closets, there's plenty of land at our fingertips right now, in our hands, actually. There's plenty of properties we can use. What we don't have is the people that are going to set aside the race, the religion, and the politics that
summed up as hate. Yeah. Just basically hate. You want them to dump the hate and do something positive, right?
Yeah. That's right. A great way to put it.
And are you still not accepting any donations? Is you still self-sacrificing?
It's still self-sacrificing organization. We do not accept money. We do not have a fundraiser.
And that's one of the things that your core values of the VOP that is different than what everybody else is doing.
Yes, and there's places for nonprofits, you know, and I don't say things to demonize the nonprofits or even other services that are available.
Because you utilize them.
Yeah, we build the bridge to get the human being to cross over into that service platform. Right now, there's no trust. There's no encouragement. It's you can't just visit a guy once a week and really develop a relationship. You go live with him for 3 days. Live what he's going through and just be there for him, not judging anything you see. And then you see how you can help him. You know, when I go and we do specific where I'm called and there's a specific chronic homeless, don't even have to be a veteran. I did it with Elmer. You know, when I went out to Circle K and lived with them on a sidewalk, took me 3 to 5 days. I was out there to get him out. But
that sounds more like therapy, where you kind of have to have the patience. The ear, you listen, you contribute. You
have to care. See, I'm looking at someone, you know, who's an elder, who's old, who's has nothing. you know, and he's alone and he's sleeping right next to the road in a dangerous situation. And he's so like crippled by his alcoholism and it was bad. Well, I got it to my first 24 hours. I just let him do what he normally would do. So within the first 24 hours on that intersection, I knew who was bringing the heroin in. I knew who was bringing the meth in. I knew where the prostitutes were tricking. You know, I knew where the bad elements were, and it's just, and we didn't interfere. But once we got past that 24 hours and we figured we had a chance to extract them, that's when, you know, we had our families come down. Mark McConnell came down and watched over us while we slept. Matt Christensen, Dante Zanone. We had three percenters, and it's very rare to find militia members that are willing to go out and do what we do. Because, you know, there's no waving a flag, protesting, thumping on your chest.
There's no great glory either. There's no like super, everyone's going to pay attention to you for doing this, basically.
Because we're going to make the stories about the homeless. We're going to make the stories about those individuals. And, you know, even if we can't get that guy to put down that bottle of vodka he drinks every day, if I can get him to drink half of what he was doing in a few days, that's a step in the right direction. See, there's too many programs out there that demand perfection right up front. And, you know, a lot of us carry demons. And
it's not human. I mean, it's that, but humans make mistakes no matter who the hell you are.
Yeah.
And so you for a point, you live with those mistakes and then you try to encourage them away from it.
You just, I tell you, the one thing you just got to do is care about them. Yeah. You got to generally care about them. They know whether or not you care about them or not. You can't con them. And, you know, I've had a lot of volunteers that came under, and people with great talents, good leadership abilities, but you didn't care about them. And they rejected you. They didn't want nothing to do with you. And, you know, if you care about them, you can reach them. Simple as that. I've never seen anyone who generally cared about someone that couldn't reach someone. We've got guys out there right now that aren't ready to come in. Nope, I'm not coming in. But instead of flat out no, after so long of us still working with them, dropping off supplies and checking on them, now it's when I'm ready, I'll come in. And pretty soon it's going to be a phone call to us. Hey, I'm ready. Will you bring me in? You know, we don't demand it right away. We don't give them a timeline. You gotta, you know, do.
So in other words, you tell the horse where the water is, and then you say you can drink it if you want to.
Yeah, but okay. We still bring little ladles out to every now and then with our supplies and check on them. Yeah,
yeah. That does show you care.
Consistency.
So, been a year. You like where it's going, VOP?
Where it's heading, it's heading in the right direction. We've got a lot more support coming from our active duty military, Davis Mifflin Air Force Base, Fort Echuca, soldiers from Luke Air Force Base, pilots. I mean, it's amazing. The National Guard, law enforcement has been, I've seen a huge change just in the way the homeless are treated in an area we operate in. Because we are engaging law enforcement. We are talking with them. They see us out there doing a good thing, freeing them up for more serious crimes, more serious issues than someone sleeping in a park or peeing behind a dumpster type thing. Or a homeless group fighting a homeless group and beating each other up. They see that we get in there and we're not just getting in there and stirring the pot. We're pulling people out.
You're making the policeman's job easier.
Yeah, but we're also, they're, when they see other people in the community show compassion and they see dozens and dozens of families come to our camp all the time to feed these guys, to sit with them, to pray with them, to do whatever it takes to treat them like a human being, they see it. And then that's what the community's doing. And that will rub off on them. And then I've seen them. They're down in Tucson. They're amazing. The Tucson Fire Department, Police Department. We just got 1,000 blankets donated. They're coming up with their trucks. I was down there to see it last week. And they're coming up, loading up their trucks. So when they went out and did service calls and came across any homeless, they would hand them out a blanket. So our law enforcement, our first responders, our active duty military, you know, we even have some politicians that lay aside the political nonsense. Richard Fimbres, Ward 5 in Tucson. You know, here's, you know, the quintessential or example of why I always tell everybody no race, religion, or politics. Him and I, we have different ideological beliefs on a political spectrum across the board that we have so many disagreements with.
But you can find a way to work together.
But he's a vet, and he sees me out there trying to find his brothers and sisters, and actually, you know, he knows. You know, you can't fake it even with the other individuals. If they really care about the people we care about, they're going to know whether you do or not. whether you're in it for yourself.
Reading people.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. So before I wrap this up, I wanted to ask, what is, in the last year since we interviewed, what is the biggest, most positive thing that you've dealt with and since we've talked last?
Oh, there's so many good stories.
There are. I mean, I remember the blue.
Yeah.
We
had Back to Blue Run where, you know, and Tucson Police Officer Association, you know, they helped carry a truckload of water down to our camp. But we've had Red Cross. I mean, I would say over in all the families that have come out and stuck with us, the ones that understand that social media is a double-edged sword, so you're going to see both sides, you know, and with me, you're going to have a million different characters, but I have to be in a million different places, and every camp is different in itself, and the streets that I go in, different neighborhoods, different homeless
I deal with. Still dealing with people on their individual, unique, unlike anybody else, one of a kind of thing. So you would sum up the most positive thing is the community that's come out to actually help. And
they've been amazing. They've been amazing. The American Legions, our law enforcement, our active duty. I mean, when our active duty takes time and come out to our bases and they bring a dinner and they donate and they ask us how they can help us. I mean, that means the world to us because, you know, we're letting them know at the same time, you know, if you go over there and you come back here, you know, you've got a place with us. If something ever happens to you and you find yourself homeless, you find us. We'll be out here. We're here for you. We're going to look for every one of you out here. And it's a safety net in a sense for them, too, because they see the veteran suicide rate. They see the military sexual assaults increase. They see the way the VA just gets worse and worse. And the more legislation they pass, the more confusing it gets. And as long as they continue to throw money and politicians at problems, nothing's going to happen until we throw love and people at problems. That's the only way things change. You know, and a lot of people will sit there and they'll agree and they'll be like, yeah, that's exactly right. But they won't take that step to go and be the person that you need to be to make it happen.
They'll talk the talk, but they won't put their words into action.
Yeah, and there's nothing really preventing them but themselves or fear of rejection. You know what I mean? I walk up to people all the time and, hey, you want to take a picture with this veteran suicide sign? Help? Nope, not interested. You know, you're going to have those encounters. That's okay. That's okay. But you keep walking up to people and you keep putting that sign out there and you keep educating them because
you're overcoming the rejection, and then you'll find that you'll get the positive.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, and then if we went to the most positive thing, what has been the most trying and challenging thing that you've dealt with since the last time we sat down and had this talk?
Just dealing with the organization itself, it's getting people to set aside their politics.
That's been the most challenging.
It's the most challenging thing.
Put their
people
hate,
wondering
hate
like
hate
who's in charge, who's in command, who's, you know, I want to be officially known as this, and
they want a name.
I want people who are going to just want to be out there because that guy down the street, you know, holding that sign with just a backpack on, he could use a little hope. That guy right there could use someone just to treat him like a human being. Just so we want people who want to do it, not for the recognition. You know,
not
how many
for
times,
the name.
I told you how many times. Don't say Louis Arthur. Don't say Louis Arthur.
Yep.
You keep saying Louis Arthur, and what happens when Louis Arthur messes up or Louis Arthur decides, I'm burnt. I've given everything I can. Yeah. I've seen it happen with volunteers.
Sure.
I mean, Louis Arthur's not a savior.
No, I
if
understand.
You put it on one man and you put me in front of the people that I'm out here for, then you're not out here for the people I'm out here for.
But as the spokesperson, you're doing a pretty damn good job, so.
But I'm out here every day. And that's the only thing is, but they have to understand there are other volunteers and other families that are out there. Even though you have some families, well, I only can bring a meal a month. You're still doing what you weren't doing before we were here. You're doing something good. You're taking one meal a month out to feed people. And if you did that and every one of your neighbors in your community, you guys would be able to cover an entire year calendar. You know,
you
every
wouldn't,
night you'd have a hot meal.
You wouldn't need more legislation of more of the same that caused the problems.
You can't throw money at a problem like this.
Yeah.
Because this is a problem that's always going to exist. You're always going to have homeless people. Stop talking about ending homelessness. No, let's just talk about making sure homeless individuals have a safe place to sleep, have good nourishment, have a restroom to use, that they're not targeted. And if they're in bad areas, let's make sure we got people that'll watch over them while they're sleeping. You know, if they really are compassionate and they care about the poor, you know, get the dollar out of it. That dollar isn't, you know, look at what we've accomplished without a fundraiser or getting paid or turning nonprofit. You know, we're blessed. We get fuel cards, you know, and we can go and we do so much transport. I mean, we just got like 1,000 that we're using in fuel cards from the American Legion. And if you looked at the week leading up to Christmas, all you saw was trucks coming in and trucks going out. As soon as boxes of supplies came in, our teams were going out to the streets, to the homeless. Here you go. If you see any veteran who needs a safe place, let them know this is where we are. Actively searching for vets while providing humanitarian aid. And we're doing this just by people donating gift cards and supplies. That's it. And we're boots on the ground. You give us the supplies, we'll make sure that we get the system operating the way it should be, and we'll complete this mission.
And you don't even care if you got recognition, just as long as you get the job done.
The recognition to go to the guys we're out here for. One of the best articles or news stories that's ever been done was done by PBS and NPR, Tom McNamara, I believe it's McNamara. But you know, and as I sat down with him, and I see he had already started everything. They had drones going over, and I told him I don't want to be in this because it's too much Lewis Arthur. That story resonated with so many more people because it was about the individuals we're out here for, not those of us who are out there for them.
Yeah.
Like I said, we can never become more important to them. So, you know, as I slowly adjust and I learn, and I'm even cutting back, you know, my social media presence and trying to push more out with my volunteers so people don't make it so much as a Lewis Arthur or Cody O'Neill or Jeff Kagan or Alan Argerby. Right. Look,
You want the spotlight to go on the people.
There's hundreds of us in Veterans on Patrol in Arizona. Hundreds. There's hundreds of us. Not one person, not even a group team. We have a council and everything, but that's because we're out here every day. But without those hundreds of us that are supporting us, we wouldn't even have a council. So we're not more important than the individuals helping us, and we're never more important than the individuals we're helping together. Never more important than them, ever. We have to have them. They're our purpose. Yeah. That's why God has them there, to humble us.
Well,
my personal belief, it's a humbling. Don't take what you have for granted. You could lose your home at any time. You're a paycheck away from homelessness yourself. How many families who would see this and would sit there and resonate, like, yeah, that's us. Don't take it for granted. Don't look down and judge that guy holding the sign as a criminal, alcoholic, drug addict, you know, bum that doesn't want to work a job.
Because you don't know, you might be that guy tomorrow.
You could be that guy. You don't know anything about that guy because you didn't take a minute to sit there and talk to that guy. You judged him based on his appearance. We'll scream about racially profiling people who look Mexican or look African, you know. You can profile a homeless person all day and day out, and they get judged all the time, and there's no one up there chanting and protesting on their behalf. That's why we're out here. You know, America wants to treat them like shit, and you want to treat our soldiers like shit and let them sleep out here on the streets and pump them full of drugs, like a pill's the answer to their problems? We're going to be out here. We're going to be out here to do the exact opposite of what you're doing. And, you know,
and coming up with more positive results. I think. That's what I think.
I'm just amazed at how God blessed our program in the sense that we have chronically homeless individuals who are living on the streets 10, 14, 18, 25 years that no one else could get. But we can bring them into our group. We can bring them into our encampments, and we can let them take their time, transition them, and actually get them into an apartment. I love that I can go just in about any city south of Prescott. There's a homeless individual or family or someone with a home now that we've helped the past year, and I can go have dinner at their house. I can go sleep on their couch. Instead of them coming to crash in my tent, I can go crash on their couch. Those are the payments we receive is when we get to go have dinner with them, when we get to go sit down at their table, and we get to look around and remember how we found you just holding that sign, you know, please help, God bless. And it's like, how much did God bless you? You know, he blessed you immensely right there. That's the payment we get. That's what
And now they're entertaining dinner for you. Well, Lewis?
Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Keep up the good work. And you know what? You could refer me to anyone that wants to do an interview, and I'll take the spotlight off Lewis Arthur.
That'll work.
Get out of here?
Get out of here, yeah.
How come?
I'm out asking you to leave.
Why?
I'm asking you to leave.
Yeah, I can understand you.
Because I said leave. This is a police scene. You are inside a police scene. Therefore, you either get arrested or you leave.
I'm inside a police scene?
You got a gun on you?
Absolutely. I have a weapon.
You have any other weapons on you? I just say take your hands down. Keep your hands up.
Water bottle, phone. I have a pocket knife in my clip above my pants right there.
Okay, you're not part of the scene.
No, I'm not.
Oh, yeah, you are. Thank you for asking. Go ahead and turn that off. So it doesn't get broken. Okay, you are inside of a crime scene. You are trespassing with inside of a crime scene.